हरिओम 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 हेलो माय फ्रेंड्स, हियर वी आर अगेन ऑन माय विंडी रूफ, सो समटाइम्स माय पिक्चर मे शेक अ बिट। I've repeatedly talked recently about how to deal with what is going on in the world because, okay, what's going on is difficult. And right now, there is again a new aspect one can worry about. I've talked about it quite a lot. If we can learn to remain centered, connected with our own well-being, and then we contribute something positive, something that helps the good forces to become stronger and to change what's going on. But now I want to mention more about our daily life, the little events that are happening from day to day in our little daily life. There are also often so many incidents coming that we are feeling offended. So many little things may come, and then there is that feeling, and there is a reaction of irritation, of anger, of not feeling well. Oh, I forgot to mute everybody. I'm going to do that right now. Okay, now everybody is muted. Then later when somebody wants to come in, you have to unmute yourself as usual. And there, actually, it's the same mechanism, like the things that are having the tendency to wait on our mood, on our conscience, on our experience that we are seeing, hearing what's going on in the world. We can deal with our own little confrontations as they come day after day, because they will come in the same way. First, one has to recognize, oh, there I'm in reaction. And this reaction is usually creating a lot of tensions in the body, energetic tensions, an unpleasant feeling, which of course we are radiating, and if people are involved, we are sending it to those people. And if we are not careful, it may also come out in our speech, aggressive, provocative, creating even further confrontations. Sometimes it may be necessary, but most of the time it's not necessary at all. And the moment we recognize that, there we can do the same thing. Instead of being locked on the intellectual, mental level and thinking, oh, they are not right, how can they, or why is this happening again? Drop that fixation and just come back to that experience immediately, not filter it through the thinking process, but immediately just watch what is happening in the body, watch what is happening energetically, watch how the tendency in the mind is to already build up argument and sending out those little arrows that may hurt. Just see that whole process right now. Focus on that instead on what brought them about. And there you become aware there is something in you that is not affected, that is full of joy even if there is annoyance on the surface. Remain centered in the timelessness of the now. And then when we from this perspective watch these reactions, then they come, they are there for a moment, and they go again. They are not draining our life force. If we hook into those emotions, whether we express them or not, the tendency is that we are feeding so much life force in that for no use whatsoever. Just to build up our self-righteousness. I'm right, they are wrong. It's happening to me again. And this we can completely just learn to leave to the side and come back directly to the experience. Watching the tensions and learning to relax. And then actually we can get energized instead of losing energy. That energy that build up the emotion, the negative emotion, the destructive tendency, that energy is getting simply without doing magical tricks. By watching it, by relaxing, by seeing what's happening, this energy has the tendency to get transformed into something beautiful, something creative. We don't have to go and look for external confrontations. We don't have to go and look for external troubles. But we have also, it's better not to try to run away from that all the time. And when it comes, then we can learn to deal with them in such a way that they are not draining, that they are not becoming destructive, and then they don't matter anymore. So it is with what's going on in the world that we can learn to accept, and still, each one for themselves, we can make something creative out of the experience. And it's the same thing with our own little daily confrontations, with our own little irritations, annoyances, that are invariably going to happen day after day, so many times. The more we can do that, the more we are free. Circumstances change. If we can, we arrange them to our liking. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. If we cannot arrange them, then the circumstances are not dominating us, they are not rattling us. Then it's just, okay, that's how it is, but I still am. I am what I am, no matter what's happening. And that beingness is full of joyousness. The more we can relax in it, the more we become aware of it. And that joyousness can be accessed even if the circumstances are unfavorable, if they are unpleasant, if they are irritating, if they are annoying. The space doesn't change. It's always here. It's never affected. Okay. Then I'm asking you, is there anyone who would like to come in? Please come.
Werner.
Hello.
Hello, Werner.
Hello, Shreya.
How are you?
How are you, Mario?
First, I'd like to say that I can relate to that whole thing about little things arising and we get very fixated on them, and it's very unnecessary.
It's just a habit that we usually build up without ever checking, and everybody does it all the time. Huh?
Yeah. I wanted to share and also ask for your comment about a couple of things that's happened in the last week or so.
Yeah.
Quite inspiring, really. Well, I listened to a podcast where there was an interview with Neil Donald Walsh. I don't know if you've heard of him, but he wrote a series of books, Conversations with God. Mm-hmm. So he went through a difficult phase in his life. He had a lot of difficulties and he was asking God, why is this happening, or how can I make this work? What could I do to make this life work? And one day he wrote it down, and then he started to get answers, and he started to get these very, very clear messages, and he wrote it all down, and he got the instruction to publish, have the book published. And he thought it would never be published and nobody would ever read it. But the opposite happened, that a publisher picked it up and they got read all around the world in the 90s. And it was an interview with him, which was, it was really good to hear him speak. I've actually never heard him speak before. A lot of people have. And it was good to kind of see him and hear him speak. And he recently, it's a couple of years ago, there's a new book, which I'm curious to see what the latest message would be. But the thing about, the thing that came out in the interview was he was saying that there are only really two like base or source, like source emotions. All emotions stem from two emotions, and that is love and fear. That all the different emotions all are based in those two emotions, love and fear. So I was kind of, that kind of made some sense to me in some circumstances, you know, like when you're afraid of losing something, you love something and then you're afraid of losing it. It's sort of like a human thing to do, then you fear. But sometimes I think, sometimes people just fear. And I don't know where the, how it relates back to this other, I missed a bit. He said there were two and that made sense to me. But then he went on to say that in fact, everything actually just stems from love. Even the fear stems from love. Sorry, I missed that bit. That's why we have fear, because we love something, and then I suppose it's like a kind of attachment, and then we fear it, and a fear losing it or whatever. And he said that, you know, we can learn to love without the fear, and that makes sense to me. But then I started to turn this over because I thought to myself, yeah, that makes sense in some circumstances, but sometimes people just fear. And it doesn't seem to be related to the love. And I found I sat with it for a bit, not intentionally, but I kind of started thinking about it during my meditation. And then I had this experience where I found that it was true that, in fact, that everything is actually love. And it was a very beautiful feeling that really that all there is love, and that there was truth in what he said. And so I suppose I would just like your comment about these things.
Yeah. As soon as we talk about love, it's getting a bit tricky, because just the different things are being called love. And you said in when you talked, just by the way, you mentioned attachment. And of course, when you mean that emotional love, that's always the tendency is attachment. And along comes the fear of losing what we are attached to. That's not what I usually call love. It's attachment, it's emotional love. But unfortunately, in the modern languages, we have the same word for different things. Like in the old language in India, you have the word sneha, like the emotional love, and you have the word prema for love, which is not an emotion. And so he talks about the emotion and calls it love. And I would say all the emotions are somehow interrelated. There are always little shades of different emotions coming together in an experience, in the present moment, in our reactions, in our expectations. And it has always to do with attraction and repulsion and fear that it's not being fulfilled. And from that comes the annoyance, from that comes the from that comes the anger. If we lose something, if there is the possibility of losing something. But anyhow, you can analyze it like that and insist on these points that they are all coming from these two emotions. I think it's not important. I think there is that whole range of emotions that we are experiencing. As long as we are manifesting in a human form, the potential of all those emotions are there. And maybe for some people it helps if we analyze and trace it back. Oh, it's coming from love and fear, from attachment and fear. But you can also forego all that and just watch the emotions. Then sometimes it may be quite surprising. Oh, this is annoyance. And actually, I never really looked at it properly. And it now I see how it feels fully. And then you can just deal with that emotion directly without having to analyze it. It's coming from here, it's coming from there. So I don't think it's that important whether you want to bundle up all the emotion coming from love and fear, or whether you just accept there is that whole range of emotions and we can learn to deal with them all in the same way, with the positive emotions and that we like, with the negative emotions that we don't like. That we learn to accept them, observe them, see what they are doing, and learn to relax, not to get hooked and make them unnecessarily bigger and bigger. So, I don't want to go too much into it and say, yes, that's how it is, or no, that's not how it is. I don't think it's very important.
Yeah, I suppose it was just interesting. Yeah. The thing that you just said there about about treating them equally. I kind of get that in a way, but at the same time, isn't it kind of a helpful thing to do to encourage like more positive kind of thinking or I suppose emotion or higher emotions rather than treating them equally? I suppose maybe it's a different approach, maybe.
Yes, you are totally right. Simply, when you start to detach from the emotions, then this is happening all by itself. And the higher emotions, then they are touching something which is not an emotion. Yes, what do you have to say?
Oh.
It's just right here. Can you see him? He wants to say something. Because then you are touching love, the higher emotions. If you are not attached on the emotional level, they have the tendency then that something is opening up, becoming more expansive, and then it leads to love, and it leads to that recognition that you are connected, and it goes beyond emotion. So, but the funny thing is, if you are not attached, if you are not fighting, if you are not struggling with what we call negative emotions, but learn to watch them and relax, they can do the same thing. That out of them, we can move into the space that goes beyond love, beyond emotions, and you are touching love. There is an approach that when you feel anger, that you try to replace it by love. It's a struggle. People can do that as an exercise. But actually, I think it's getting easier, quicker, more profound by just accepting what emotion is there, but not encouraging it, but also not fighting it. Just watching it, and then through the emotions, you go beyond the emotion, if you watch that. And even if the emotion is a negative one, it still leads you to that space where you are connected with all, and that's the real love.
I think, the observation is the really important thing to really watch. When you do really watch what's happening, there is a natural discrimination that takes place without you thinking about it, that you tend to discard what's not helpful by observing. And the thing about acceptance, it's something that it's like, it's funny because it's like acceptance is like, it's almost like a contradiction, because it's something that you need to work on, but it's actually not working on it, working on something that helps you to accept it. It's kind of an odd thing, because we don't realize, like, I know that things come up for me, like, you know, negative emotions or past memories that I have a negative kind of, layers on top of. And I don't think, like in your mind, it's like it's hard to think that, oh, I'm holding on to them. But of course, we totally hold on. I'm totally holding on to them. And, I think, oh, surely it's there, so I'm accepting it. But actually, I'm not really accepting it. And it's like somehow it takes a while to kind of really get that full acceptance that it's absolutely fine. I don't know. That's what I find.
Right, you are right. Basically,
you get there.
It should be natural, that acceptance, but we have learned not to be in that natural state, that we always are struggling with everything that is happening in the circumstances, in the outer circumstances, and in the so-called inner circumstances, what the emotions and the stuff that is coming to our mind. And so that habit is so strong of struggling with it that we have to relearn again something that should be natural, that acceptance. And so one can work on it at least by reminding oneself and see, look what I'm doing again now. Now there I'm again creating total resistance, and when I see that I can work on it, I can let it go. And that actually leads to that natural acceptance. It's right that the acceptance directly, it's not something that you can do, but you can encourage it. And you can see what is standing in the way of it, the resistance that we are creating, and we can work on that. And when that acceptance is there, even when negative emotions come, then, right, you need not really do much about it, just you see what is happening and you're relaxing and they quickly pass. And then we don't have to first somehow with an emotional trick try to change them into positive emotions. Then they just pass and you become aware of that space that is prior, beyond the emotions. And you can reach that even with negative emotions and also with positive emotions. We just have to learn not to take the emotions so important. We're taking them too important. They're becoming too big. That they are an enrichment of the human experience, but they should be in their own level and not be made bigger and bigger all the time. And so we don't even need to cultivate positive emotions, but use the emotions to go beyond the emotion. And there we feel connected. There is love. It is something you can say, it's like a feeling, but it's not an emotion. I just don't know a better word for it. So you're a noisy fellow. Okay. It's, you know, there's nothing wrong with what you're saying, the tendency, the direction, cultivating positive thoughts rather than be negative about things. But it's not so much that we have to try to cultivate positive emotions. If we are not creating negative emotions, the emotions are very easily positive and help us to go beyond the emotion, to that sense of being connected, which is not an emotion.
I think it's like the letting go, the acceptance and letting go. Yes. And then it allows positive emotions, you know, this higher emotion, I suppose, to arise. I think there's ego involved there as well, this feeling of separateness that contributes to negative emotion. Mm.
Right. But, of course, on the level, and the spark of that will remain. I mean, as long as the body exists, a spark of it remains. But it doesn't, we can get so detached from it that it loses its power to bind. But somehow, as long as that human appearance is there, a body is there, that little spark of ego is in a way necessary to survive. That you feed this body and that you look for your space and all this stuff. But if we identify with it and get all tense, then it becomes big and creates a lot of trouble. If we see, okay, it's just momentary the role I'm playing on this human level, then there is no problem about it.
Okay.
Is the crow very loud on your side?
I can definitely hear the crow.
Yeah, is it disturbing?
I can still hear you.
Yeah.
I can also hear the crow.
Yeah, maybe I'll have to ask them how to go a bit farther away.
I'm just wondering if there was something else I was going to say.
Okay.
Yeah, anyway.
I sent the crow away for, and then we can continue. Hey, tell let's see how long it takes, because they are teaser. They like also to tease the dogs, because my dog's getting very irritated by them, and then they tease them and fly in front of their noses. Okay.
Anyway, this experience of love that I had was very, very helpful, I have to say. I kind of needed it, because now I feel like sort of the things that are going on. Maybe the crow doesn't want me to talk anymore. I don't know. But I'm nearly finished. I was just going to say that this experience helped me just accept what's happening in the world at the moment. It's like, you know, it's at the base of everything. I really felt like at the base of everything is love. Yeah. And so these things don't matter so much. You know, yeah. It's like what you say. They're not as important as we think they are.
Yes, and it's very nice what you have experienced, what you're describing, but without being aware of it, you have moved beyond the emotion. That love you experienced there is not an emotion. Of course, it's a joyous experience, but it's beyond an emotion. It's not the emotion by definition. They come, they have a peak, they go. But that love actually is always there. So simply we are not always aware of it. But it is the base, that pure love, that connects everything. Out of that, everything is coming.
My teacher used to call it divine love.
Yes, you can call it divine
love. He would talk about human love and divine love.
Right.
And describe them differently.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
All right, thank you so much, Ren.
You're welcome. Ario, Ario.
Ario.
So you had your say now, huh? Naughty fellow? Oh. He's aware that I'm not angry, really angry. Not very impressed. Oh, I see Manuela. Would you like to come in?
Yes, please.
Yes. Hello, Manuela.
Hello, Werner-ji. Nice to see you. So, yeah, I mean, I can relate to everything what you said, and I hear it a lot of times that not attached to the emotions, to observe it, be centered. And I can say for myself, the small things, daily things, I'm often very good to come back to me, but there are sometimes so heavy emotions which are related to our trauma. So then I really feel in a beton, in a concrete tube, cannot move anymore. And there is a part in me who can observe the attachment to the feeling, to the emotion.
Yeah.
But still, it's so overwhelming, and it's just not for me, not possible to relax in. And of course, I know there is resistance and blah, 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 blah. But I have the impression I always come to a wall and there is no way through somehow. So I don't know. I mean, with really overwhelming emotions, I don't know how to be, okay, I can say to myself, okay, I observe it, I'm centered, but it's not helping at all.
Right. Of course, there are the relative easy things to deal with, and then there may be heavy, very powerful things that they are deeply rooted in the subconscious, and it looks like impossible to just accept them, watch them, relax them. If they are connected with stories of which we are conscious, then it helps to let those stories come up and let them play in front of our mental eye from the beginning to the end, and try to be still in the present, not again back in that story, and to see how the emotions are building up, how they are changing during those memories, and learn to relax as good as we can when we do that. And gradually the charge of it is disappearing. But sometimes there may be traumas and we don't know exactly where they are coming from, where we are not aware of stories. And when we are aware of that trauma, then still you may not be able to just watch and let go and relax. But still, by observing, then you don't feed them anymore. And even intending to relax, even intending to let go, is doing something also when we, in the present moment, when we are doing that, not exactly feeling an effect still. Slowly, if we do that again and again, the charge is lessening and they become weaker. And eventually the point will come where you will be surprised that you can let them go. I mean, there are other ways. The people go and do shamanic rites and all kinds of things. I haven't done those things. I don't know how much they work. I think with some people they have worked. What I'm telling, that I know very well from my own experience, it does work. But sometimes heavy stuff, we have to accept that it may come again and again. And if it's connected with stories of which we are conscious, it helps very much to accept, okay, let the story come up and go again through the story with all the unpleasantness that is involved. But try not to get involved into my position and the other position, on poor me and I'm right and how can they, but just let the memory come and the emotions come and see what it is doing now. And in the now, we can relax at least to some extent. And then what I used to do sometimes is also play games that I'm changing the story as I would have liked it to be, and play with those emotions. Or sometimes give a lot of aggression back in the mind and observe what kind of emotions it invokes in the present, right now. But then come back again, just in the present, and let this old stuff come. And sometimes certain things that were quite heavy, they came, but when I was with that consciously enough for some time, then it would go and I felt, finally it's gone. But it wasn't really gone, because the next day the same stupid thing may have come back again. And if I could let it go, I let it go. But if it was too involved still energetically, if it was too powerful, I had to learn to surrender to the fact, okay, more work is needed. So instead of trying to be quiet and trying to be cosmic and trying to be expansive, then I accept, all right, then I'm being busy again with my mental stuff, and let it come again, and let the story come again, the memories come again, let the emotions come again. and observe and relax as good as it goes. And gradually, even those things that are powerful, that are overwhelming, that we think we cannot really get rid of, they are weakening. And eventually, the same things that had the power to keep on creating trouble, they become so weak that they are just a story.
I think I missed the point with the relaxation. How does it work? How the hell does it work, the relaxation?
Right. The easiest is that you start to relax on the easiest perceptible level. Relax physically, as good as it goes. Relax your legs. When you feel all worked up in that stuff, in the emotions that come with it, and then the tendency is that we always are getting all tense physically, and especially, I found out for myself, and then I saw other people are doing that also all the time. We are our legs are getting all tense. So the very simple thing of then redirecting the attention to consciously relax our legs, relax our feet, is already changing energetically something, and then it's changing emotionally and intellectually something. The more you relax the body, if you start to relax in your legs, the rest of your body also starts to relax more. And the more you start to relax your body emotionally, energetically, the tensions are loosening up. And then emotionally, also we are not more so obsessive and intellectually holding on to things. So start to relax on the level where it's easiest, physically. We may not be able to just completely physically relax, but if we give the impulse, at least we relax somewhat. Mm-hmm. And from that somewhat, we can relax a little more. Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah, there's maybe no more patience needed.
Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes when I used to say these kind of things, people thought who had been busy with spiritual things for a long time, then they thought, I mean, what can you do relaxing your legs? How can the fellow talk like this? And had quite the resistance and never tried. And it may have taken a long time, and then they tried and they said, oh my God. it's so easy and it's so efficient. Mm-hmm. Once I said to one man who had been practicing for a long time, and we were talking about dealing with anger. And I said, if you have the presence of mind to remember when the anger comes, try to relax your legs. He thought it's completely nuts. And later he came and said, I couldn't believe what kind of a difference it meant. It's just totally changing the mood of the situation. This kind of simple thing, they are very powerful. But the difficulty is that we, with our sophisticated mind, are not so easily ready to accept that silly, simple things like this could do a lot. No, it should be. It should be much more complicated than that. My experience throughout the years is that the simplest practices are usually the most powerful. If we have that mindset to be ready to really do it, to try it.
I will do.
Right. Very good.
Thank you very much, Renaldi.
You are welcome. Ario.
Ario. Ario.
Is there anybody else who would like to come in? You're welcome. what I just said at the very end with Manuela, that is the simplest practice, simplest practices are usually the most powerful. This is something that was very important for me to discover in my journey. You have the tendency to think that in order to really get somewhere, what we are doing has to be complicated. We were brought up like this. In order to get some good effect, result of something, there is very complicated, complex procedures to get there. And so it is in our life situations. We have to think about it more, we build up strategies. The opposite is the truth. The simplest is powerful. But the thing is, what is not so easy with simplicity is that if we don't have immediate results, then we think, okay, of course, it's because such simple things they cannot do much. But then, even if we learn very complicated practices, we may have immediately results for some time, and then it fades away, and then we do the practice, and then there are also not necessarily visible results. That's with all that we are doing. Sometimes we have visible results, sometimes not. But if we have the patience, if we have the courage to do simple things, they are very powerful. Okay, I see somebody is here. Ah, Daniela? Do you like to come in?
Yeah, hello, Werner. Yes, why Mukti. Not?
Mukti, huh?
Mukti.
Yes. Mukti. Hoi, Mukti.
Hello. Nice to hear you, really. I appreciate this meeting and your talk and all the people, what they're saying. I mean, we live in the world. I live in the world. I have a busy work, and then I use the weekend for recover, to relax, and then it comes, I feel just empty, and there is so many things actually I would like to do, I'm interested in, but I don't have the motivation is gone. Because there is the life force, however, has been used, is finished. And this consciousness that we can relax in the world is not known most in the normal business daily life. And it's really difficult. I feel like that. I mean, yeah, it's my pattern.
Yes, it's a pattern of very many people.
And then I just go and see some movie. I go television because I have no energy. I just want to. It stops in my mind. It stops all this. I should that. Actually, I like to do it, but when it starts, I should. This and this, and then I feel I don't know actually what helps me then come out of this. Also, yeah. Maybe you can say something about that.
Right. Yeah. It helps if you have every day some time where you are not busy. also not watching movies. There's nothing wrong that as a recreation you watch movies. By all means. But if you have every day some time where you are not busy, where you just can be without thinking, now I have to do this, I have to do that. And even if those thoughts come out of habit, that you step a step back and relax and let them come and go, and as good as you can, not getting interested. But you just have some time where you do nothing. That can be short time, that can be when you have more courage and more time, it can extend, and when you have less time and less courage, you can reduce. But it's helpful if you find at least a few minutes every day that you just sit down and relax. And then when the busyness of the day, today life wants to come and invade, then you can see it, then you can, as good as you can, just step a step back. And then bring that attitude as good as you can into your daily schedule. And then when you are all tense in your daily life, then as long as you don't remember, as long as you are not aware of it, you cannot do anything. But then when the memory comes and you see, oh, there, I'm doing it again. I'm all tense, I'm all worked up, I'm all into the stress of the situation. There you can for a moment just again stop. Not for long, just a moment stop and redirect the attention. And now I'm giving you Werner's magical formula. What to do in such a situation. Do you have a point in your body where you are centering most naturally, easiest? Do you know that?
No, not really. The heart.
Okay. Okay, I would recommend you that you experiment a bit and watch and observe.
Okay.
Where you are centering most naturally in your body. And then make that your center of attention.
Okay.
That you, whenever you become aware how the attention is getting all over the place, then first center, and center physically. And then along with the centering, consciously breathe, within, without, number two, first center, number two, breathe, number three, relax.
Okay.
Center, breathe, relax. That's the magic formula.
Okay. Sounds easy, yes.
It is not difficult.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes the moment you have the memory and you really do it, it immediately makes a difference.
Yeah.
Still, the situation will be there. You will have to find a solution to the whatever is going on. But at least you stop building up more stress about it and think, you just a moment.
Yeah, that's like exactly that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That just a moment you stop and consciously center, breathe, relax.
Yes, good. Very good. Yeah. I'll try that. Between the work, but also the point you said, where in my body is at the
center.
Yeah, the center. I don't really know that actually.
Yes, and use that. Use that when you sit quietly for meditating. Center also. Use that whenever you remember, when you're walking down the road in a crowd. Center. When you're sitting in your office and on the phone and fighting with people, if you remember, center. The more you do that, the more naturally, automatically it will happen that you center. It's not that you are in one point more than everywhere else. It's not that the self is more in one point in the body than in the other places, but it's a reference point for the mind. And the more we use it, it becomes like a gateway that gets more and more powerful. It's like that's a gateway, and right behind that is what you are. It's that immovable part of you that is not on a particular place, but can be accessed through any point. And if we have a point where we are centering naturally and we use that again and again, then that can help us immensely in dealing with tense situations.
Yes, I try that.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
Very good. Yeah. Wish you good luck with it.
Thank you, I'll tell you later.
Yes, you can always come and tell how it works.
Yeah.
Okay, wish you well. Mario. All right. Is there anybody else who would like to come in?
Hello, Werner.
Hello, Dial.
Hello, Werner. I want to ask you that many years I was indifferent for political situation in the world.
Yes.
And I was focusing on the spiritual, reading books. In this, but about 8 years ago, I find out if something has come to my mind, if I'm different to politics, it will come by itself to me. And also I find out that the internet is very powerful. And
what is very powerful? I didn't understand.
Internet, the social network.
Okay, internet is very powerful.
Internet itself. And opinion of many people bring influence to the situation for many things you can do. So when I start participate into information war.
Yes.
So I'm reading everything and I'm saying my opinion to everybody in reality and in the internet. So, and it takes a lot of time and also it takes my energy as well. So how to find other way? Because I see it's not very big, my influence is there, but not so big that I have to use all my life to do that. So can you comment this?
Yes.
How to find another approach?
It's not that you the solution would be that you close your eyes now and you just create a wall and no, I don't want to know anything. I mean, some people, they are interested less, some people are interested more. And if that interest is there, you can inform yourself. It's good to know when you inform yourself that you have to take everything that you hear with caution, with a grain of salt. You understand that expression, you take it with a grain of salt?
Yeah.
Yeah. You don't have to believe everything that you hear, because unfortunately, the news, they are always traffic. They are always, in a way, influenced that after that they give the information out that certain powers want to give out. So that is the first thing, that you just don't take it as God's own truth, what you hear and what you read. That maybe it's already twisted. Then you can form your opinion, but that is, and then if you get, you said sometimes you talk to people, you may get into arguments, you may get into discussions, then learn not to take yourself and your opinion so serious. And if other people have other ideas, then let them have other ideas. If they want to convince you, you can say, no, I have another idea, then you don't forget it, don't waste your time. But you also don't have, it's also not your duty that you go around and try to convince others of your ideas. And then you can feel the connection, that you feel connected. You can inform yourself. And if you see things that are really upsetting you, then you work first on yourself and your emotional reaction. And then if you find that peace in yourself, if you find that harmony in yourself, and you connect with what has been upsetting you, then actually you're contributing something very creative, something very beautiful. But if you inform yourself and you get more and more depressed of all the things that you are hearing and more fearful, then the whole information is making your experience smaller and painful. And actually you contributing with those, holding on to those emotions, you're contributing to that aspect that you really don't want to manifest in the world. When we hold on, get all depressed, when we hold on to anger about what is happening, when we stay with all that, I mean, it may come a moment, it may go again, no problem. It comes, it goes, it doesn't leave a trace. But if we hook into that and feed it and remain with it, then actually, usually, people who do that, they feed exactly that which they don't want to happen, which they don't want, they feed the negativity. But if you inform yourself and you are confronted with terrible things that you hear and see, and you see your reactions, but then at the same time you learn to become aware that there is, in spite of that, there is that aspect of you that is not affected by it. And you learn to connect with that, then, and you connect with the situation that brought all that emotional reaction up, then if from that perspective you connect, then you're really supporting the creativity, the beauty, the lightful energy that helps, that brings a very good aspect in your personal life and also in the collective and in the situation you are thinking about. So be careful when you inform yourself that the information doesn't pull you down into dark holes, because then we are contributing to the darkness. And even if it pulls us momentarily in a dark hole, then let's see it, recognize it, and not be angry about all the others that have done that, but first work on ourselves and work ourselves out of that darkness. Become aware there is that shining light in you that is never dark. And then connect from that perspective, and there your life will be light in spite of negative informations. And you contribute something into the world, in the collective, that helps to maybe turn around that negative situation.
Okay, Werner. I think I'm another problem. I take very serious everything what is happening and take my responsibility for everything. So just before, I was thinking this is a dream. It's not so important what is happening around. So I don't have to participate in everything. So, but now I believe this is real. And also I have the habit to convince everybody. Even before, I was spending a few years to fight against Neo Advaita. Always try to convince all the people who is going to this satsang. So yeah, I will work on these habits, and also I understand I have to think about emotions and energy, what is inside of me, more than information and I give. So this is more influence to the others.
Right.
Okay.
But the world is as real as we give reality to it. Even if it's very frightening, even if it's very big what is happening, it's good to remind oneself maybe it's not as real as it appears to be. It's good to remember why we are here, what we are here for, why we are in this magic show, in this world. It's from moment to moment to learn, to explore the self, to unfold the experience of that self-existence, of self-consciousness, not of self-importance, me, 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 but of that awareness of being alive. Everybody has come for that in one way or another. Some have this kind of stories they want to go through, some kind other types of stories they want to go through, but basically this is a learning place, this world. That's what we are here for. And it's good to remember, even when the events seem to be overwhelming and we are totally taken up and have the tendency to just take it as a total reality, to remember, hey, come on, I'm here to experience it. I'm here to learn. And then when I see from that perspective, also when I start to take responsibilities personally about things where I can personally not do anything about it, then I can also see, hey, I'm taking just myself as a person much too important in the whole story. And I can relax about that. It doesn't mean that you should now be indifferent and think it doesn't matter when there are atrocities going on. Yes, it matters. On its own level, it matters. And if we can do something about it to improve it, by all means, let's do something about it. But for most of the situations, most of us, we cannot directly do something about it. So then we don't have to feel guilty and responsible. And if I'm not doing anything about it, then it continues. We can do something about it by not contributing more tension and more darkness, by making your own experience light and radiated lightness. And there actually you do contribute something very, very valuable, that situations may change to the positive.
Okay, thank you, Werner. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Very helpful.
Hurry on, hurry on, hurry on. Is there anybody else who would like to come in? You're welcome.
Hello, Werner.
Hello, Nelly.
Yeah, Werner. I want to share something. Last time I feel myself more aware how joy is important. Yes, and now I learn to practice in more and more. I saw that all my life I had a lot of some kind of gloom mood and some sadness from my family. it was like a habit to be worried about something, to think of something, to be serious, and yes, and now I'm aware that this is like I was detached from my roots, because as you say, that joyousness is our natural state.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, and I last days I became aware of it so clear that when I lose my roots, when I lose this kind of joyousness, I lose my roots, and I feel myself weak and no stability, and yes, I just disconnected from my roots. Yes, and I learned to practice joyousness, to be in joy. Yes, and this is now important thing for me. I try to remind myself all the time when I go in my thoughts and become worries about something and so on, to remind myself that about this joyousness, and yes, and helps to come back into here now, to yes, just like make a kick to myself that hey, don't be in this mood,
right?
Look around. Everything is beautiful.
A good kick.
Yes, yes, it's so wonderful when I feel this glimpse and this connection with joyousness and with myself. Yeah, it is like I feel the other part of myself that I did for some time.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, this is very beautiful. I remember what you say.
Very
yes,
good.
Remember great. What you say about this. Yeah. Mm. And one more thing I want to share, that I see that praying helps me too, to relax.
I see.
Yeah. Yeah. When I feel tensions and worries, yeah, I sometimes I just pray and I feel this surrender in myself, and it really helps to some kind of feel relaxed. Yeah. And I feel that when I sit and watch my breath, it seems to me that I feel less tension. Of course I can't be sure of it, because sometimes I feel it more, sometimes less, but it seems to me that it happens when I feel less.
Right. And it will be like that. Some days it will go easier, sometimes it just nearly effortlessly you are at ease, at peace, and then on other days it may be a bit more a struggle to come back again. That is not that sometimes you do it better and sometimes you are not doing it well. It's just so many influences contributing, how it goes, whether it goes smoothly or whether it goes difficult. But if we, with patience, with perseverance, continue, the tendency is definitely it's getting gradually easier and easier, and eventually it's just being the natural way of existing.
Yeah. Yes. Last time I felt in my meditation that I could sit maybe 40 minutes, okay. Yes, I felt okay. But then last 20 minutes, I felt more thoughts and more tension, and And in the end, I thought maybe I should finish my meditation before this stuff becomes so intensive, because it seems to me that I sit and think and more tense and become more tense. And I thought about that maybe I should finish. I just wanted to ask you about it. But then I didn't stop it, and it seems to me I should go on. And sometimes it is really easier. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I'm not going to tell you do like this or do like that. You have to figure out that for yourself. And everybody has to find for themselves the equilibrium between pushing a bit on one hand and not hurting oneself, not torturing oneself. And it's different for different people. So find out whether it's worth the trouble to sit out also 20 more minutes, or whether maybe it's better to get up, walk a bit, and maybe sit again for some time. Or whether you just want to reduce it. A little bit of discipline, a little bit of endurance is certainly very helpful. But then each one has to find out how much is helpful. If we overdo it, it slowly becomes more like a self-torture, and that's not necessary. So, but if you feel, as you said, sometimes you thought that you should maybe get up, and then you're feeling now slowly it's getting easier, then maybe you can try to continue and see whether it continues getting easier.
Yes. Now, at least at last days, it is easier. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you, Werner.
You're welcome. Hari Om. Hari Om.
Hari Om. Hari Om.
Is there anybody else who would like to talk? You're welcome.
Hello, Werner.
Hello, Moksha.
Hi, man. Nice to see you. I was just, it made a click to me when Nelly was speaking. I'm very thankful for Nelly, what she's telling, that with sadness, she said something like it is a habit to behave in a certain way.
Yeah.
And it suddenly made click in my head. Ah, yes, I have also some habits and I was very thankful that she says it is just when she said it makes click in my head. Oh yeah, it's just a habit, nothing more.
Yes,
we pick up things and we keep on doing it automatically, and it was so nice when she said it. I said, oh yeah, I have also such a habit to be so serious in some points.
Yes.
It's just a habit. Nothing yes. more.
Yes.
What a gift to hear this and suddenly get, oh shit, I have this also.
Yes.
And then it's easy. Stop it. Just stop it. It's just a habit. Nothing more. Not a big thing. Not heavy situation make out of it. Just a habit. Okay.
Yes.
See it. Stop it. Easy.
Of course, the habit will push you that it comes back and wants to repeat itself. But if you are aware of it, then you can say, there it comes. I see you.
not a big thing.
Yeah.
It's not make that heavy thing. Again. Nah?
Yeah. Right.
Okay. If it's come back, also fine. No problem.
Habits, mental habits, are like other addictions. If we have been doing something again and again, then that craving is there to repeat it. And so our mental habits, even the negative mental habits, even if it makes us sad and gloomy and unhappy, they are, in spite of that, addictions. And it's not so long ago that I understood that I learned that actually it is also a physical addiction, that the different emotions, they are producing different kinds of peptides in the body. And even if we repeatedly have negative emotions, then that kind of peptides that is being produced in the body, that we are craving for it, that we want it back. Even if it's an unhappy experience, it's just an addiction. And to feel in a certain way, I mean, it's much more, but even on the physical level, it's an addiction. And mentally, just mentally, just to have a certain emotion again and again and again, the tendency is that we just want to have it, even if it's an unhappy emotion.
Yeah, and it is, and through the words of Nelly, it was strange. I suddenly, oh yeah, it's just a habit.
Yes.
It is what you say, I don't have to like it. It is just a habit.
Yes.
Oh, I walk 10 times in that street. I don't have to think about it. I just walk there. Do we want to walk there? I want or don't want. I do it. Yes. It's just habit.
Yes.
And to see, oh, I can do it. If the awareness is there, I can easily say, hey, do I like it? No, then stop it. But if you're not aware of it, I walk already in the street again.
Yes.
Even not aware of that, I can change or do it different. It's amazing, huh?
That's exactly the thing. The awareness makes all the difference. As long as we are not aware, people are not aware how repetitive their life is. How again and again and again, the same emotions, the same reactions, the same, totally predictable. It's just repeating in slightly different circumstances. The same story is repeating itself all the time. And once we become aware of it, it may be a bit shocking to see, but then there we can start to change it. And say, no, I'm not going down that alley now all the time.
I'm totally amazed now that, yeah, it sounds strange maybe, but I always thought, oh, it is heavy to change and blah, blah. But sometimes some are very easy. You just have to see it.
Yes.
It is crazy that I have, for me, this point now that came up, I'm sometimes so serious in certain things. And till now I didn't see that that's a habit. You can also take it easy. It's just a habit. Mm. Eh? This is extremely easy if you see it, right?
Mm.
But if you don't see it, it seems impossible to change anything.
Right. It's easy if you see it and you sincerely want to change it. That sincerity that we want to change things comes out of the feeling, no, I'm fed up. I don't want to suffer.
Yeah.
I don't want to create pain unnecessarily anymore. I've had it. Yeah. Enough. Enough is enough.
Yeah. That is what Nelly said. Also this, yeah, the heavy, and if I heard her speak, sometimes something in me resonated. What you said, I think it's enough. Why do this suffering all the time? It's not necessary. Stop it.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, great gift.
Great, good.
Funny how things comes in certain moments. It's funny.
Yes, that's great. Mm. Mm.
Yeah, I often repeat your words for myself, like don't take it so damn serious. That comes deeper and deeper in my system, that I took it off damn serious.
Yeah.
And it is only making it heavy.
Yes.
It doesn't bring anything. It doesn't, it only makes it heavy.
Yes. Right. It's not that, it is, that you are more efficient or anything if we take it so serious. In contrary, if we can go about it playfully, then we don't lose our efficiency. Sometimes we are more efficient.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah,
that has to do with it. If I don't took it damn serious, it was like you have to take it damn serious, otherwise you are not doing it right or something.
It's irresponsible, it's irresponsible not to take it serious. You have to take it serious.
Yes. You take it on the light shoulder, right?
Yes.
Very bad.
Very, very bad. You have not understood the seriousness of life.
Yes, and the heaviness and the problems. You have to understand and see the problems everywhere. Right. Otherwise, you are not... Yeah, this is deep down in the system, right? In the collective also.
Deeply.
Heaviness is reality.
Yes.
Having a light life, you're doing something wrong, man.
Yeah.
You're enjoying and having a light time. There must be something wrong with you.
Yes. It's strong. That suggestion, it's strong. I remember how I was surprised finding in myself a resistance to be happy, a resistance to feel good, because I think I cannot just feel happy, I cannot just feel good. This is like as if it was something immoral.
Yes, irresponsible. You are not responsible. Yeah. You take it on the light shoulder. Hmm. Maybe it is Christianity, maybe it's coming from, right?
Oh, the church has certainly contributed a lot. It's not Christ's message. It's also in other places. It's not only in the Christian, but the Christian teaching has very much built on guilt and that kind of stuff. That's for sure. But it's also here. It's also amongst the Indians a bit different, a bit less fixed, maybe, but it's also that.
Yes. It's amazing, huh? I know that a teacher of mine told also, what did he say? That it makes me really angry in the beginning. Yeah, also about fun and lightness. Then I was always thinking, he is not serious.
Yeah.
That serious, it must be heavy, you know?
Yeah.
It's the same stuff. Mm.
And if we stop,
just enjoy life.
If we stop
life, no?
Getting limited and imprisoned by that kind of feeling, that kind of thinking, then we become aware. It's easy, as you say, it's easy to be joyous, it's easy to be happy, and actually you contribute something very beautiful to the collective, and especially to those around you who are in immediate contact with you.
Yeah, that I feel, because with my sons or with my ex also, no, this is really serious. It makes it only heavy. It's nonsense. Nonsense. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you, Werner, and thank Nelly, and you both. Thank you very much.
Very good.
Hariom.
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 Yes.
So I think we'll stop it for today. Except if there is something very urgent that somebody wants to talk about. we have covered already quite some ground. So, Hari Om, Hari Om, Hari Om.